Thank you. please rise in honor of this family? On behalf of the Kelly Kemp family, thank you for joining us today as we celebrate his life, but most importantly, as we celebrate the Christ who saved him, Jesus Christ, the God of all the ages. We're reminded of the most popular scripture in all of Christendom from John's Gospel, chapter 3, verse 16. If you know it, please say it with me. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. We're also reminded in St. Matthew's Gospel, chapter 22, that they came to Jesus and said, Master or Rabbi, which is the great commandment in the law? And Jesus said, to love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, and mind. This is the great and foremost commandment. The second is likened to it, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments hang the law and the prophets. And so today, we're reminded of the love of God, agape. The love of God, the attitude of God, the actions of God, and the answers of God. Romans chapter 5, verse 8 says that God demonstrates his love toward us, that while we're yet sinners, Christ died for us. And ultimately, 1 John chapter 4, 7 and 8 says, he that loveth not knoweth not God, for God is love. Say that with me, please. God is love. Let's say it together. God is love. And today we celebrate the love of God. Let's bow our head and pray together. As we pray together, Chase Darr is going to open us with prayer. Hand him the mic and he will pray for us. Let's pray, please. Amen. As you're seated today, Brother Lindy's going to come and lead us in one of Kelly's favorite hymns, I Know Whom I Have Believed. Let's sing it together.
I know not why God's wondrous grace to that he is able.
Thank you, Lindy. As we celebrate and we worship together today in your program, there's an obituary. I want to read it today because I want you not only to be able to read it, but to hear it yourself. Kelly Kemp was born the youngest of three brothers to Milton Garland Kemp and Bertie Adeline Crutchfield Kemp in Prattsville, Arkansas, on July 30th, 1934, and went to be with his Savior from his Little Rock home on July 24th, 2022. The Kemp family joined Lifeline Baptist Church in the early 1960s when they moved to the Cloverdale area. They left the state briefly in 1971 but returned in 1976 to Arkansas and to Lifeline, where Kelly was a longtime deacon. Not mentioned in this obituary is the fact that not only did Kelly Kemp serve as a deacon, he also served as a Sunday school teacher, and he would serve on various committees through his tenure at the church. And he also would meet and go on visitation with us when I first came on Monday evenings. Every Monday evening, Kelly was ready to go on visitation. Also, anything that I would ask to be built, Kelly would be the first to sign up. Kelly could build almost anything, and he could build it, and he would have it ready for us to go. Also, until COVID, every Sunday morning since I've been here for almost 15 years now, the deacons would lay hands on me and pray for me, and Kelly Kemp was one of those deacons. And every time that he could be there, he would lay his hand. They would go around in a circle, and he would pray for me. I've told many of those guys I want them to be at my funeral service when I go to be with the Lord. And Kelly said, I'll go before you do, but I'll go happily. And Kelly did. And so not only is he a longtime member of Lifeline, but he's very active at Lifeline Baptist Church, and Lifeline loves Kelly Kemp. Kelly enjoyed puzzles, bird watching, going for long drives, baking bread, making fudge, listening to music, and building things with his hands. No life can be summarized by a few words. However, some of the most recent comments from family and friends give a tiny glimpse of how Kelly lived his life and the loss of his absence brings. He's lovingly been described as a good leader, a godly man, respectable, kind, exceptional, etc., etc. Kelly was forgiving, supportive, stubborn, and he was extremely hardworking. He told me one of the first times that I met him that he was stubborn, and he would say that Jerry could attest to that better than anybody else. Miss Jerry, how many years are you married to Kelly? 66 years. Give the Lord a hand and thank him for that marriage. 66 years. He was kind, and he was giving, and he had integrity. As a young father, he played his role as a pony without complaint whenever the kids wanted to ride around the house. As a young family man, he was often away on jobs but made time to come home at least every weekend as often as he could. As an older man, he continued to work hard in the construction industry. He was called out of retirement many times before finally being allowed to slow down. As a grandfather and great-grandfather, he was more likely to be found holding the children in his arms or lap instead of giving pony rides. He was a good father who raised daughters who loved him. He was a good husband who helped provide a good life, 66 years as we heard. He was a good friend who enjoyed helping others who needed a hand. Kelly was preceded in death by his parents and his brothers, Milton Kemp and Stokes Kemp. He's survived by his wife, Jerry Louise Adar Kemp, and their daughters, Carrie Kemp Joyner and her husband, Tim, and Elizabeth Darr and her husband, Joseph, by grandchildren, Sarah Holderfield and her husband, Chad, Charles Darr and his wife, Katie, William Darr and his wife, Lauren, Anna Grace Warner and her husband, Robert, and seven soon-to-be-eight great-grandchildren, Audrey Darr, Mary Darr, Sterling Holderfield, Fabled Holderfield, Philip Darr, Elijah Darr, and Leo Darr. And yesterday we celebrated his life by committing his body to the ground and in Sheridan, Arkansas. And again, we want to thank you for being with us today. Let's stand together today and sing I'll Fly Away and remember today that one day we all have a better home waiting for us. Brother Lindy. Bow our heads and pray together today. As we pray together, Pam's going to come and sing for us one of Kelly's favorite songs. As we pray together, I'm going to ask Will, Kelly's other grandson, to pray for us today.
Lord, thank you for this time to remember Papa and to remember his life and to be thankful for the hope that you've given us. Thank you that you promised that we will all see each other again at the resurrection and that you will wipe every tear from our eyes, Lord. We thank you for your presence and your comfort in this time. And we just thank you for the time that we have shared with Papa. And we look forward to seeing him again in glory, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. You may be seated.
Dreamed of a city called Glory, so bright and so fair. As I entered the gate, I cried, "Holy, the angels met me there. They carried me from mansion to mansion.
That's exactly what we'll do when we all get to heaven. We'll sing glory to the Son of God. And today, Kelly Kemp is singing glory to the Son of God. He's no longer in a broken body that's dying. He is alive and well. And we're reminded of that today as we celebrate his life. I had many opportunities over these years to talk to Kelly about life and death and hell and heaven. And no doubt, just as I know whom I have believed was one of his favorite hymns, he not only knew Jesus Christ as his personal Lord and Savior, as the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, but he knew him as the one who died for him and for his sins. And so today we think about the fact that Kelly has been very sick for a long period of time, and Miss Jerry and Carrie and Beth and their families, they've watched this patriarch of their family, this husband, this dad, this grandfather, lying and dying, and he's not dying anymore. He is alive and well. And we're reminded of the fact that Jesus prepares us for death in St. John's Gospel, chapter 14, in verses 1 through 6. He says, "Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you, and if I go to prepare a place for you, then surely I will come again to receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. And Thomas, also known as Didymus, said, But Lord, we do not know where you're going or the way. And Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but through me. And so as much as I love God, as much as I love God's people, I always want to make sure that folks know that there's only one way to heaven, and Jesus Christ is his name. And so in these years of ministry, and many of those spent happily here at Lifeline, there have been questions about life and death and hell and heaven. And because I've had deacons that served the way that Kelly did, I've been able to talk to groups and to men and women to share the gospel. And over these years, there's been one other question and answer that's been added. But the first most popular question that I get about life and death and hell and heaven is what happens to the spirit. People want to know what happens to the spirit. Most people, regardless of where their faith is, they believe that a human being has a spirit. So what happens to the spirit? Remember in Jesus' case, he was crucified between two thieves. During the duration of the 6 hours that he hung on the cross, both of those thieves began by mocking him. At the end of those 6 hours, one of those thieves simply said to Jesus, Rabbi, remember me when you come into your kingdom. And Jesus said to that thief, This day you shall be with me in paradise. Paul teaches it this way in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 8, to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. And so when Kelly took his last breath in that body, his spirit immediately went into the presence of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Now for the unbeliever, St. Matthew's Gospel chapter 22 addresses that question as well. What happens to the spirit of an unbeliever? That spirit immediately goes into what's called the second resurrection, into a place called hell. And so that's question number one, what happens to the spirit? Question number two is, what happens to the body? And so the Bible teaches us that as a result of sin, that every woman that gives birth, that she's going to have pain, have a new baby coming. We know what that, I do not know what that looks like or what that feels like, but women do. Go ahead and say amen, women. And because of Eve's sin, women are punished with pain. And that's still true today. And he told mankind, when you work, you're going to have the sweat of your brow. And he told Adam, when you work, you're going to have the sweat of your brow. And he told mankind, you're going to return to the dust from which you came. And so today we understand that the body is either going to be cremated or buried. I get a lot of questions about cremation versus burial. He tells mankind, you're going to return to the dust from which you came. One just gets you to dust a little bit quicker than the other. But he teaches us also in 1 Thessalonians that one day the dead in Christ are going to rise. Jesus is going to split the eastern sky. The dead in Christ are going to rise. And I believe that that's when the Bible teaches us that we get our new bodies. Right now, Kelly is in heaven in spirit. When Jesus comes from the church, 1 Thessalonians 4:11 and following, then the dead in Christ are going to rise, and those that remain are going to be caught up to meet the Lord in the air. That thus where we get the idea of I'll fly away in the rapture. And so I want you to look to the person sitting next to you and say, I can't wait until you get your new body. Go ahead. I can't wait until you get your new body, because we're all going to get a new body. So what happens to the spirit? What happens to the body are questions one and two. The third most often asked question that I get is this: are we going to recognize our loved ones in heaven? We think about Carrie and Beth, Miss Jerry. Are we going to recognize Kelly Kemp in heaven? The Apostle Paul answers that question in 1 Corinthians 13. He says, we will be known as we are fully known. And so I do believe that we're going to recognize our loved ones in heaven. The fourth question that we often get about life and death and hell and heaven is simply this, and it's, are we going to get to eat in heaven? Kelly would like that question and answer. We just fed the family. The Bible says in Psalm 23 that thou hast prepared me a table in the presence of my enemies. If the Lord prepares a table, it's going to be good. And in the Revelation chapter 21, it talks about the wedding feast of the Lamb. When the Lamb, Jesus Christ, and the bride, the church, come together, there's going to be a wedding feast. I've never been to a good wedding that didn't have good food. So I do believe that we'll get to eat in heaven. The good news is that we will not eat anything that kills us, and we will not eat anything that makes us gain weight in heaven. And so we will get to eat in heaven. And then the last, the number five question that I've often gotten about life or death or hell and heaven, and we think about 66, 67 years of marriage, is what kind of relationship are we going to have with each other in heaven? They came to Jesus in St. Matthew's Gospel, chapter 22, again. They were trying to accuse him of blasphemy so that they could hang him on the cross quicker. And they pointed out that there was a Jewish woman, and she was married to a Jewish man by Jewish custom, and he died. And she married his brother, and he died. And by Jewish custom, she married the next brother. I always say I would not have wanted to marry into that family. Everybody was dying. But she did, out of obedience to the scriptures. So they said to Jesus, whose wife is she going to be in the hereafter? And Jesus said, none of their wives, because we're going to have relationships with each other, as do the angels. And so I've had people to say over the years, why aren't husbands and wives going to be married in heaven? Well, I've never met a husband and wife that didn't argue, and there's not going to be any arguing in heaven. Never met a mother and a daddy that didn't argue with their children. Not going to be any fussing or fighting in heaven. So we're going to have relationships with each other, as do the angels. Now, you remember the angels. Remember that Satan was an angel. God created him, and he could choose God or not choose God, and he went against God, and he got one shot, and he and some of his fellow angels were kicked out, according to Isaiah 14:12, which is a scripture about the king of Babylon, but 14:12 specifically is a picture about the fallen angel Lucifer, and so he is kicked out. I would rather be a human being than an angel, because angels only get one shot. Human beings get grace. And Kelly Kemp had experienced the grace of God. And so because of Matthew 22, sometimes we think that when we get to heaven, we're going to be angels. We're not going to be angels. I'd rather be a human being than an angel. I want you to say to yourself in your head, I'm never going to make it as an angel. You would rather be a human being than an angel. A few years ago on the campus of the University of Arkansas, I'd met a young German guy that's here on a golf scholarship, and they had asked me to come to the university and to share these most and oft-asked questions about life or death or hell and heaven, and I did. And this young man had prayed to receive Christ as his personal Lord and Savior. And so after the presentation that night, he said, well, Jeff, I want to ask you a question. He said, I know enough about the Bible to know that the Bible says in Revelation that there are not going to be any tears in our eyes. And Will made mention of that a few moments ago. No crying in heaven. And he said, my mom and my dad are not believers. My younger brother is not a believer. He said, so if I get to heaven and my mom and my dad and my youngest brother is not there, he said, I'm going to cry. He said, what does the Bible say about that? I said, well, I don't know. I said, let me look into it and let me find out and I'll come back to you. Sometimes we think we have to have all the answers. Friend, I don't know about you, but I don't have all the answers. I have a God that I do not have to figure out, but I have a God that has me figured out, and I'd rather it be that way than the other way around. And so I searched and searched scriptures, and finally, one afternoon in my office, I found Psalm chapter 34, verse 16. And Psalm chapter 34, verse 16 is one of the most sobering scriptures that I've ever read. In Psalms 34, 16, the psalmist says, the face of the evildoers will be cut off from the face of the earth up, and their memories wiped out. Now, I don't know about you. I want to have a memory of every person that I know. And that's why I want to share the gospel with people that I know and that I do not know, because I want everybody to go to heaven. If even their memory is going to be wiped off from the face of the earth because they did not believe in Christ, then I believe that it's the church's responsibility to share the gospel. Only God can save, but God's called the church to share the gospel. And so I think about life, death, hell, and heaven, and sharing the gospel. Maybe today you're sitting in the pew in this church and you're thinking, well, Jeff, what if you and the 66 books of the Bible are wrong and there is no God? There's no Jesus. There's no Holy Spirit. The scriptures are nothing more than a historical book, which I agree, it's history, it's his story, and he allows me to be a part of it. What if you say, well, Jeff, I do not believe in sin, and I do not believe in a place called hell or a place called heaven? Then I just simply share at that point that you're a braver person than I am, because we have, the Bible says in Romans chapter 1, verse 21, the sun, the moon, and the stars that bear witness that there's a God. It's called general revelation. Over and over, and today I've shared with you that Jesus is Christ of all the ages. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians 15 that he lived and died, buried in a borrowed tomb, and raised from the dead 3 days later. That's specific gospel. But you say, well, what if I think that there is no God, there's no Jesus, no Holy Spirit, the Bible's not true, there's no heaven, there's no hell? Then I would just simply ask you this question. Are you willing to take that gamble? Because if you're right, and there is no God, there is no Christ, there is no Holy Spirit, there's no heaven, there's no hell, the Bible's not true, at the end of all the ages, when you come to your deathbed like Kelly did his, then you've lost absolutely nothing. But if God and 66 books of the Bible are right, and God's people and sharing the gospel are right, and there is God, there is Jesus, there is the Holy Spirit, there's a place called heaven and a place called hell, then you've lost everything. Most importantly, you've lost eternity. Kelly, born the same year as my dad, I could keep up with his age. He lived periodically, in our eyes, a short life. But compared to eternity, you think about life and death, hell and heaven. Ms. Jerry asked me specifically to share the gospel, and so let me take just a few moments to go into detail. As we think about the gospel, the Bible says in Romans 3:10, there are none righteous, no, not one. In Romans chapter 3, verse 23, the Bible says, for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Paul says, I was chief among the sinners. Kelly would have said that as well. In Romans chapter 5, verse 8, the Bible says that God demonstrates his love toward us, that while we're yet sinners, Christ died for us. I get to share the gospel a lot. As I share the gospel, people that tell me I don't believe in anything about God or the book, they still believe in sin. Why? Because sin is so present in the world that we live in. Day in and day out, now more than ever, we're confronted with death and sorrow and separation. But God says he demonstrates his love toward us that while we're yet sinners, Christ died for us. Romans chapter 6, verse 23, the most horrific scripture to me in all of Christendom, says, the wages of sin is death. That's why we are here today, because of death. Because Adam and Eve went against God. God gave them grace, unlike Satan, either for God or against God. But God gave Adam and Eve grace. He even covered Adam and Eve's nakedness by killing an animal himself. The first picture of the sacrifice is in the garden. And he wants to give you grace today. The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. And so we understand that Romans 8:16 says that God's Spirit bears witness with your spirit that you're a child of God. Had a man to tell me one time, well, I don't like many preachers. I said, well, I've met a lot of people that didn't like many preachers. I've met preachers that didn't like preachers. But you don't have to have a preacher. God's Spirit bears witness with your spirit that you're a child of God. You see, you can think what you want to think about a preacher. You can say what you want to say to a preacher. But ultimately, at the end of the day, God's Spirit will bear witness with your spirit as to whether or not you're a child of God. And remember, St. Matthew's Gospel also teaches us that the only unpardonable sin is blaspheming the Holy Spirit. What does that mean? Denying God with your last breath, blaspheming the Holy Spirit. Romans 10:9-13 tells us how to be saved. Salvation's threefold. He first tells us in Romans 10:9, the first part of that, to confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus. The word confess is the Greek New Testament word homologia, the same logic. You don't have to be on the same logic with me as a pastor or the Baptist or this group or that group. You need to be on the same logic with God. He needs to be Lord of your life. He was Lord of Kelly Kemp's life. And then you need to believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, and then you shall be saved. according to Romans 10:9. Twofold right there. You see, even the demons in hell believe that there's a God according to Peter. You know why? Because they were with him and they got kicked out of heaven because they went against him. You're either for God or against God. And then the third part of salvation is Romans 10:13. Whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. So I need to do three things in God's sovereignty to experience God's sovereign salvation. I need to confess, believe, call. Say those words with me, please. Confess, believe, call. Let's say them again. Confess, believe, call. If you've not done that today, then you think about that last question, question number 6. What will I do if I get to heaven? My loved ones are not there. What will I do if I'm willing to gamble that there's no God, no Jesus, no Holy Spirit, no hell, no heaven? The book's not true. Am I willing to take that gamble? It's a big decision. We think about Kelly Kemp and his life. He loved God enough to live for God. We look at people in our world, they love their religion enough to die for it. Jesus doesn't ask us to make sacrifice to die for it. He asks us to love him enough to live for him. Confess, believe, call. Would you bow your heads with me, please, and close your eyes? Our pianist is just going to begin to play. I've decided to follow Jesus. I'm not going to ask you to walk down an aisle. I'm not going to ask you to stand up and shout. But because I believe that we're closer to the end of the age than any other group of humans have ever been, I do want to give you opportunity today to confess, believe, to call on Jesus Christ. Maybe on site or online, and we're live today so that Lifeliners could participate in this service, so that Miss Jerry will have a remembrance. If you're on site or online and you've never asked Jesus to be your Lord and Savior, you're not sure, would you pray a prayer like this right now and mean it with everything you have in your head and your heart? Would you say, Lord God, in Jesus' name, I confess I'm a sinner. I want to be on your logic. I need you to be the Lord of my life from this day on. I do believe that God raised you from the dead, and I want resurrection power to turn from my sin, to repent of it. I want resurrection power over sin and over death, and the power to live for you. And I call on you right now, save me. Please save me right now. Nobody's looking around. Thank you for your great respect today. Again, I'm not going to ask you to walk down an aisle. But if you prayed that prayer today and you're on site and you say, Jeff, I prayed that prayer. Jesus said, if you're not willing to confess me before men, I'll not be willing to confess you before my Father who's in heaven. You prayed and asked Jesus to save you today. All I'm going to ask you to do is lift your head so I can pray for you. Lift your head and look into my eyes. If you prayed and asked Jesus to save you, would you lift your head right now and look into my eyes that I may pray for you? Anybody? Amen. Yes, ma'am, I see that. Thank you. Anybody else that prayed that prayer? Anybody else that prayed that prayer? Yes, sir, I see that. Thank you. Anybody else today in this house that prayed that prayer? Anybody else? Thank you. God, in Jesus' name, I pray that you would bless this family. God, I thank you for those that prayed to receive you today. I pray, Lord God, that we would rise up and be the churches that you've called us to be, the families that you want us to be. God, we're losing day after day, year after year, we're losing our Kelly Kemps in churches. God, help some men to rise up to be a Kelly Kemp, to be like that. God, I pray that you'd help families to rise up to be families that not only pray together, read scripture together, but come to church together. God, help us in this nation to have strong Christian families and churches. We need revival. And I pray, Lord God, that you do that through your people, the church. God, I thank you for Miss Jerry, the way that she loved and cared for Kelly, the way that she would bathe him, feed him, not leave his side, sing to him, read to him, sit with him. God, I thank you for husbands and wives and mamas and daddies. I thank you for Carrie and Beth and their children, these four grandchildren, these great grandchildren. God, please intervene in our lives. Thank you for this church. But most of all, we thank you for Jesus, who lived and died and was raised from the dead, that we could face each day. We love you and praise you in Jesus' name. God's people said, our instruments are going to begin to play. Back at the back, Brother Lindy's going to help me. He'll go back, and starting at that back, he's going to dismiss you to come down this aisle. And if because of COVID, we want to be safe, so you may just want to smile, but we want Miss Jerry to know who's here. So you'll walk down this aisle over here and greet the family and pass by and come back down that aisle. Thank you for being here today.